So to put up a counterpoint, last time we touched on ghosts, and there were these good ghosts, which are the Fideiv Popov ghosts, and then the more problematic one, like Deser, and I don't know how to pronounce Balware.
I would say Bolwar Deser ghost.
Bolwar. Okay, yeah. Bolwar Deser ghost. Great. Okay. And then there's also the polytype ghosts. So those are the ones you don't want. And they produce, say, negative probabilities. Now, the Klein-Gordon equation initially faced rejection over negative probabilities, and I believe Schrodinger came up with it first and just didn't even publish about it because of that reason. But then there was another switch in point of view where, okay, the Klein-Gordon equation is not only okay, it's requisite. We use it in the standard model. So do you see that there's some other point of view where what's seen as a fatal flaw here is no longer for negative probabilities or unitarity or even locality conditions?
So as you say, we certainly use ghosts in some formulation, like for the Fideiv-Popov ghosts. We use those ghosts almost as a trick. When we have some symmetries, for instance, it's easier for us to work with a formalism where we take too much into account, and then we use those Fideiv-Popov ghost or related ghost to cancel out contribution that we know shouldn't have been there in the first place. And we do that a lot in many different things, but they are under control. And you have to think of them as a mathematical trick. You have to think of this as a formulation. We give too much away, and then we know how to control what we've given too much away, and we know how to remove those things. So in that sense, it's a negative, it violates unitarity in the sense that it has a negative contribution and negative energy, but of just the right amount to remove the positive contribution that we had added on. And so in that sense, that is completely under control. Now, there are other situations, like the Bolwar Deser ghost, where this is not something which has been added to remove another contribution. It's just something that comes in its own accord. Mm-hmm. And you can see in the case of the Bolwar Deser ghost why it starts becoming problematic. And it's particularly problematic because you're dealing with modes related to space-time. And so let's just imagine a little bit what you mean by gravitational waves. You know, we have observed gravitational waves, and the way we have observed them is them distorting space within our interferometer, distorting the space between two mirrors in our interferometer. And so they make the space between the interferometer evolve in time. But you can, in principle, we are dealing with a theory of space-time, you can, in principle, think of having the same thing with time. And then if you start having a mode for gravitational waves, which allows you to jiggle things in time as well, then this is also related to some level of causality violation. And so this notion of breaking unitarity with some of those ghosts can be linked directly to a violation of causality. And as soon as you enable for that possibility to happen, then you're opening a whole Pandora box of pathologies which are not under control, because this is not something that we engineered precisely so as to remove another contribution because we were lazy in some sense in the first place. Mm-hmm. It's something that just populates your space-time by its own accord. It's not under control. So you may think, well, does that have a raison d'être? Does it have its own way of thinking of it? In some sense, from the formalism, yes, you can analyze it. It is a pathology, and as a scientist, you can analyze it. You can try to understand it. You can look at its structure, and it has a lot of interesting features in its own right. But at the same time, you know that this mode, it is a pathology. You can't have it in your space-time as a fully dynamical degree of freedom in its own right. That you can't have. It is a little bit different as compared to saying that you have an instability. So, for instance, the Higgs potential is unstable within some range, and you may think that this instability may be the sign of a pathology. But that is in fact just a time evolution, and is just a transitionary behavior from one point to another. And you can think, for instance, that the whole evolution of the universe is something that signals some level of instability, because we are going into a different configuration. We are evolving in the evolution of the universe. Those are not, they're not pathologies. They are just the reality, and we may not like that. Think it's never necessarily pleasant to be in an unstable configuration, but we can deal with it, and that may just be the reality. The issue with the ghost is that we know that that tells us there's no vacuum. There's no ground zero around which we can think about our theories. And so we can't even start looking at the model into how to represent anything. As soon as you have this actual negative kinetic energy mode, a genuine degree of freedom that has, who delivers energy when he moves, we know that there's no ground zero in which we can start thinking of our whole quantum field theory framework. So in that sense, we can't even start doing anything.
So speaking of energy, what is energy? Especially in general relativity, what is gravitational energy? And what is this criteria or wish list that you would like a well-defined definition of energy to have, like locality or covariance or what have you?
Yeah. Okay. So for me, I don't have so much of a wish list for energy, because I don't have the need of having this concept as being as fundamental as we may have otherwise have. I think we're very much driven by almost a Newtonian perspective of things being static in time, and this symmetry in time tells us that there's an associated conserved quantity which we call energy. So it's almost a luxury to have energy as a conserved quantity and as a well-defined quantity that we can rely on, and we can rely on to predict phenomena and to understand how you can borrow energy from one system, give it to another system, and that the whole energy within a box, let's say, should be conserved. Now, as you said yourself, when you have gravity in the game, things become much more complicated. There's no local conserved, ordinary conserved notion of energy in the same way that we would think we should have in otherwise. And that in our everyday life, we follow the rules as if a notion of energy was conserved. This is related to the fact that gravity is in fact a spin to particles, so it behaves slightly differently. And so the stress energy tensor is no longer conserved, ordinarily conserved. It's covariantly conserved, but that means that the conservation of the quantities related like energy, they're not absolutely conserved. There's a borrowing, or there's a trade-off between the energy of what we call matter, let's say, and the energy of space-time. A system can can borrow energy from the space-time, or just dwell energy into the space-time. And that disturbs us a little bit. And we know this, maybe a simple example to think about, which helps us a little bit into making the analogy into how we think of energy being conserved in normal system and how different things are with gravity. Let me just imagine that I have two stars. Let me imagine I can start having one star, and that star is emitting light. It's emitting electromagnetic waves. And so that star is losing energy. At one point, it will die, and that's sad, but that's life. It's losing energy, but this energy is being carried by the electromagnetic waves. It's being carried by light. And so in principle, if I take that star and then I were to draw a sphere around that star, I can compute the amount of energy lost by that star, but also the flux of energy carried by light, by electromagnetic waves, within that sphere around, or that box, whatever, around that star. And I have a complete trade-off between the amount of energy being lost by that star and the flux of light going through that surface. And so we have this very well understood notion of conservation or trade-off of energy in a normal system. Now, if I do the same thing with gravity, So let me just imagine, instead of having one star, let me just imagine I have two stars. I can do that as well.
Sure.
And so they will lose energy through light. They radiate light, but they also radiate gravitational waves. We actually need two stars rather than one for gravitational waves to be radiated. And that we know. In fact, there are some systems where they lose more energy through gravitational waves than they lose energy through radiation of light. So it's not something which is simply innocent. It's actually, it can be quite substantial. So for some system, they lose most of their energy through the radiation of gravitational waves. And you could, in principle, ask yourself, if you could do the same thing, let me just draw a sphere that encompass those two stars, and let me think of the energy lost by that system of two stars. So they're losing losing the chemical energy. They're losing some energy inside each of the stars, but they're also losing some of their potential energy because they're getting closer and closer together through the radiation of gravitational waves. And I can think I'm a little bit further away from these two systems of stars. I drew a sphere around them, and I compute the flux of gravitational waves through that surface and the flux of light through that surface.
Yes.
And that doesn't work in the same way. There's no such a notion of local at a given finite distance away from these two stars of energy which is conserved.
Hmm.
For that system, I will really need to go to infinity. If it's asymptotically flat at infinity, if I recover flat space-time at infinity, then I'll be able to finally define a whole notion of energy which will be conserved, but only because I'm in flat space-time asymptotically. And only in that case, I'm able to define a local standard notion of energy. And that's because the notion of energy is very much a consequence of some symmetries of the space-time. You need to have a time-like healing vector to have a conserved charge, a conserved quantity related to that.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.